thank you for joining us. We're going to go ahead and do a sample problem here to see if you can understand what you might need to do on a ventilator given a specific situation. So let's say that you were covering a patient who was in AC mode. So you would see this. You'd see AC 12. That means 12 breaths per minute. Tidal volume 400. FiO2 of 40%. And a PEEP of 5. And let's say that the blood gas results were 7.26, 60, 55, 26. So for those of you who don't know, this is the pH, that's a little low. This is the PCO2, that's a little high. This is the PO2, that's low. And this is the bicarb. And for those of you who don't know how to interpret these, please look at our medical acid-based lectures. The pH is low. The PCO2 is high. Because these are going in opposite directions, this has to be a respiratory disorder. Because the pH is low, it's a respiratory acidosis. So we're underventilating here, most likely. And also, the PO2 is low as well. So we're underoxygenating. So what things could we do to these vent settings to improve this patient's blood gas? Let's assume that this patient is sedated. And when I say that, that should clue you into the fact that if the patient's AC is set at 12, that means they're actually probably breathing at 12. That's important because if they're not sedated and they're set at an AC of 12, they could be breathing at 16 or 20 because they're controlling the rate. But if you've sedated them with morphine or Ativan or Versed or some other sedative, then their respiratory center may not be functioning and they may be what we call riding the vent. When they're riding the vent, they're sedated and their AC is at 12. Now, if I were to drop this rate, they would probably follow it down. Or, of course, if I were to increase the rate, they would follow it up. Now, the opposite is true if they're not being sedated. Let's say that they're not being sedated, that their AC backup rate is set at 12, but they're breathing at, let's just say, 18. If they're breathing at 18 and I increase the AC rate from 12 to 14, am I really doing any change? No, I'm increasing the backup rate, but because they're breathing well above the backup rate, that is not going to have any effect on the blood gas. But what I'm telling you here in this case is that they are sedated and they are what we call riding the ventilator. So they're at an AC of 12 and they're actually breathing at a respiratory rate, or what we call a spontaneous respiratory rate of 12. So what could we do to improve ventilation and oxygenation? Well, based on our previous discussion, you know that we could increase the AC to 14 or 16. Okay, you could also use odd numbers, but we just like to use even numbers because it's just easier for some reason. Tidal volume doesn't need to be at 400. 400 could be a little bit low. We could go up to 500. So those are two changes that we could make, both which would improve the pH and reduce the PCO2. Now let's look at our FiO2. It's at 40%, and our PO2 is pretty low at 55. The PEEP is 5. So there's a lot of things we can do. We can change either the FiO2 or we can change the PEEP. If this patient's blood pressure is marginal, I'm probably not going to want to increase the PEEP. And as we told you before, the reason why we don't want to increase the PEEP is because increased PEEP increases intrathoracic pressure. Intrathoracic pressure increases the pressure in the right atrium. Increasing the pressure in the right atrium decreases venous return. And as you know, decreased venous return reduces cardiac output, which reduces blood pressure, i.e., increased PEEP decreases blood pressure usually. And so if the blood pressure is marginal, I'd probably want to go with increasing the FiO2 on the ventilator to improve our oxygenation. Now, on the other hand, if this patient is a congestive heart failure patient on the ventilator, then we have plenty of venous return coming back to the heart and probably some pulmonary edema in the alveoli. Increasing the PEEP to like 10 in that case may actually be beneficial, because that increased end expiratory pressure is going to push that pulmonary edema out of the alveolus. It's going to increase the right atrial pressure, push back that fluid that's congesting it, and allow the heart to work at a better efficiency. And so you can see here that depending on the clinical situation, you may want to choose one versus the other. And we're going to sort of get into some special circumstances here coming up. But I wanted to show you that as a possibility. So if we were to get a blood gas later, 7.40, 40, 80, 26. Okay, so now you know how to adjust vent settings. Let us look at a couple of special cases here. Let's look at a thing called ARDS. Now, what is ARDS? ARDS is adult respiratory distress syndrome, or acute respiratory distress syndrome. It used to be known as adult, but it's acute respiratory distress syndrome. This is an inflammatory condition which affects the lungs diffusely, and you can see it after any type of infection. I'm talking urinary tract infection, pneumonia, aspiration, terrible ARDS. And here is basically what happens. The lungs become very stiff, so the compliance of the lungs drops. Because of that, you'll see elevated plateau pressures. Sometimes you get pneumothoraces in the lungs. Here's the key though, you get a restrictive lung physiology, the lungs become very, very stiff. And as a result of that, it's also, there is, in the alveoli, there is a lot of hyaline membrane that gets deposited. And so as a result, if you were to look microscopically at the alveoli level, they would be filled with fluid and they would be collapsed. Now the problem is that they had found in research studies that when they ventilated these people with high tidal volumes, it was opening up and closing these alveoli, opening up, closing. Every single time the patient took a breath in and out, they would open up and close. And that led to one thing and one thing only, and that was inflammation. And that, they believed, led to death. So they had an idea. They said, let's go ahead and do something different. Let's do something called the open lung model. And the open lung model was this. Let's go ahead and stent open as many alveoli as we possibly can using high levels of PEEP. Okay, so we're talking PEEP around 12, 14. It just depended on how much the oxygen was diminished by. The lower the oxygen levels were, the higher levels of PEEP that they used. They felt that if the oxygen was low, that these alveoli needed to be recruited, and the more they needed to be recruited, the more PEEP they added. So as they added this PEEP, they were able to open up these alveoli. Now, with these alveoli open, they didn't want them to de-recruit. In other words, they didn't want them to close. And so what they did was they had just tiny tidal volumes. So the key here is high PEEP, low tidal volume. And what I mean by low tidal volume, I'm talking 6 to 8 milliliters per kilogram ideal body weight. By the way, ideal body weight is measured by your height. So you measure somebody's height, and that converts into what their ideal body weight is in kilograms. So once you know what that is, multiply it by 6 to 8, and that's the range of tidal volume that you should be using. We're talking usually in the 4 to 500 range, okay? When they did this type of strategy with ARDS, they found that survival improved, mortality went down, and they were able to affect change. And so that is the standard of care now with ARDS. So if you have ARDS in a patient, you want to make sure that you're using low tidal volumes and increasing your PEEP for recruitment. Okay, let's talk about the other special case, COPD. Completely, completely different problem. The compliance of the lung in COPD is actually high. But the problem here is that these airways are obstructed. And so it's very hard to get the air out. As a result of that, air gets trapped. And because air gets trapped, the key there is that you have very long expiratory phases. Now, the key with this is these patients that come in typically have high CO2 levels. And the temptation there is when you see a high CO2 level, it's to do what? It's to increase the respiratory rate, and it's to increase the tidal volume. Well, when you do that, you're increasing the amount of air in the lungs, and it takes longer for that air to get out. You need more time for that air to come out. Otherwise, you're going to stack another breath on top of the old one. Well, if you're increasing the respiratory rate, you're not allowing more time. In fact, you're allowing less time for that air to come out. Think about it this way. If the respiratory rate that you set on a patient is 12, how much time do you have for a complete breath cycle? You have 5 seconds, because 12 goes into 60 seconds five times for 5 seconds. Let's say you set the rate to 15. How many seconds do you have then? 4 seconds. So you can see that by increasing the rate here from 12 to 15, you chopped off an entire second per breath to get that air out. So the key here is normally when somebody takes a breath in, it's usually one-third, two-thirds in terms of inhalation and exhalation. Okay? What we can do in COPD is we can actually affect the time it takes to take a breath in. This is called the inspiratory flow rate. And typically, it's around 60 liters per minute. Now, in patients with COPD, what do we want to do with the inspiratory flow rate? We would love for that air to get in very quickly so that we could have more time for exhalation. In other words, we want to decrease the inspiratory time by increasing the inspiratory flow rate. So in other words, get the air in quickly so you can have the rest of your 5 seconds to have the air come out. And so my recommendation for inspiratory flow rates, and indeed the society's recommendation, is they should usually be around 80 to 100. So if you can get the air in quickly, you have more time for that air to come out. And avoid the temptation to increase the respiratory rate, because you may actually make the carbon dioxide worse by increasing the respiratory rate or the tidal volume. So the strategy that I would employ in somebody with COPD is make sure that the inspiratory flow rate is high, make sure they're getting very good bronchodilators, and look at the flow volume loops on the ventilator. Make sure that flow is returning back to zero before the next breath goes in. Because if flow is not returning back to zero before the next breath is being initiated or air is going in, then you must be getting breath stacking. And if you get breath stacking, you can hyperinflate. And if you hyperinflate, you will increase the intrathoracic pressure to be very high, which is going to decrease cardiac output. And the patient will code because their blood pressure will go down very low. By the way, the treatment for that is to simply disconnect the patient from the ventilator so they have time to exhale and get all that air out. So that is COPD. That is a special case. We could talk a long time about that, but I think we have discussed the basics here over the last few lectures. We've talked about what the ventilator is. We've talked about what the endotracheal tube is, what it looks like, what its purpose is, what the different modes are, what kind of alarms there are, the peak pressure, the plateau pressure, and how to affect change on a ventilator using these settings. And now finally, a couple of special cases. So I would practice these things, read up more about it, and we can talk a little bit more about specific cases and the ventilator in future lectures. But I think this is a good basic introduction to what the terms mean and what to do on the ventilator. Thanks once again for joining us.